بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وبعد. This is the 13th lesson that we've reached, the 13th sitting in the book titled Majalis al-Shahr Ramadan by the author Sheikh Muhammad ibn Salih al-Huthaymin rahimahullah. And this chapter is with regards to the etiquettes of reading the Quran. Fi adabi qira'ati al-Quran. So the Sheikh begins and he says, الحمد لله الذي لشرعه يخدع من يعبد ولعظمته يخشع من يركع ويسجد ولطيب مناجاته يسهر المتهجد ولا يرقد ولطلب ثوابه يبذل المجاهد نفسه ويجهد يتكلم سبحانه بكلام يجل أن يشابه كلام المخلوقين ويبعد ومن كلامه كتابه المنزل على نبيه أحمد نقرأه ليلا ونهارا ونردد فلا يخنق عن كثرة الترداد ولا يمل ولا يفند أحمده حمد من يرجو الوقوف على بابه غير مشرد وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له شهادة من أخلص لله وتعبد وأشهد أن محمد عبده ورسوله الذي قام بواجب العبادة وتزود صلى الله عليه وعلى صاحبه أبي بكر الصديق الذي ملأ قلوب مبغضيه قرحات تنفد وعلى عمر الذي لم يزل يقوي الإسلام ويعدد وعلى عثمان الذي جاءته الشهادة فلم يتردد وعلى علي الذي ينسف زرع الكفر بسيفه ويحصد وعلى سائر آله وأصحابه صلاة مستمرة على الزمان المؤبد وسلم تسليما. So the Sheikh starts off with his introduction and he says, the rough translation of the meaning, all praise is due to Allah, the one whom every true worshipper humbles to his legislation and everyone who bows and prostrates yields to his sovereignty, and due to the sweetness of holding a conversation with him, every true worshipper stays up in the night, forsaking his bed, i.e., praying the tahajjud or qiyam al-layl, and due to the quest to obtain his reward, the striver sacrifices his soul and toils. He, glory be to him, speaks in a manner that is far from resembling the speech of the creation. From among his speech is his book that was revealed to his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We repeatedly recite it throughout the day and the night. It does not get faded due to continuous repetition, and neither does it get boring. I praise him with the praises of the one who hopes to stand at his door without being forsaken, and I bear witness that none has the right to be worshipped but Allah alone without any partners. I bear witness that Muhammad is his slave and his messenger, the one who carried out the responsibility of worshipping the Creator and prepared for the hereafter. May Allah bless him, his companion Abu Bakr, the one who filled the hearts of his haters with an exhausting ulcer. Umar, the one who continued to support and strengthen al-Islam. Uthman, the one who was not hesitant at his martyrdom. Ali, the one who winnowed the plants of disbelief with his sword and harvested them. And the rest of his family and his companions, we ask for them a continuing blessing and mercy forever. So then the Shaykh continues and he says, Ikhwani, Inna hadha al-Qur'an alladhi bayna aydikum تتلونه وتسمعونه وتحفظونه وتكتبونه هو كلام ربكم رب العالمين وإله الأولين والآخرين وهو حبله المتين وصراطه المستقيم وهو ذكر المبارك والنور المبين تكلم الله به حقيقة على وصف الذي يليق بجلاله وعظمته وألقاه على جبريل الأمين أحد الملائكة الكرام المقربين فنزل به على قلب محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم ليكون من المنذرين بلسان عربي مبين وصفه الله بأوصاف عظيمة لتعظموه وتحترموه فقال تعالى. So then the Sheikh says, I'm just going to stop there because there's a lot of ayahs to read, so I'm just going to translate the first paragraph and then we'll read the ayahs inshallah. So then the Sheikh says, oh my brothers, this Quran which is before you, which you recite, listen to it being recited, and which you memorize and write it, it is a speech of your Lord, the Lord of the worlds, the Lord of the first and the Lord of the last. It is his firm rope and the straight path, i.e. the Quran and the Sunnah. It is a blessed reminder and the book giving light. Allah has spoken with it in truth in a manner that befits his majesty and his sovereignty. He sent it with Jibreel, alayhi salam, the trustworthy and honorable angel who is close to Allah. He sent it down to the heart of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in order that he be from those who warn in an eloquent Arabic language. Allah has described this book with great attributes in order for you to honor and respect it. He, the Most High, said. So we're just going to read through a series of Quran ayahs, and then I'll go through the translation. So bear with me, because there's quite a few. شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان ذلك نتلوه عليك من الآيات والذكر الحكيم يا أيها الناس قد جاءكم برهان من ربكم وأنزلنا إليكم نورا مبينا قد جاءكم من الله نور وكتاب مبين يهدي به الله من اتبع رضوانه سبل السلام وما كان هذا القرآن أن يفترى من دون الله ولكن تصديق الذي بين يديه وتفصيل الكتاب لا ريب فيه من رب العالمين يا أيها الناس قد جاءتكم موئذة من ربكم وشفاء لما في الصدور وهدى ورحمة للمؤمنين كتاب أحكمت آياته ثم فصلت من لدن حكيم خبير إنا نحن نزلنا الذكر وإنا له لحافظون ولقد آتيناك سبعا من المثاني والقرآن العظيم لا تمدن عينيك إلى ما متعنا به أزواجا منهم ولا تحزن عليهم واخفض جناحك للمؤمنين ونزلنا عليك الكتاب تبيانا لكل شيء وهدى ورحمة وبشرى للمسلمين إن هذا القرآن يهدي للتي هي أقوم ويبشر المؤمنين الذين يعملون الصالحات أن لهم أجرا كبيرا وأن الذين لا يؤمنون بالآخرة أعتدنا لهم عذابا أليما وننزل من القرآن ما هو شفاء ورحمة للمؤمنين ولا يزيد الظالمين إلا خسارا قل لئن اجتمعت الإنس والجن على أن يأتوا بمثل هذا القرآن لا يأتون بمثله ولو كان بعضهم لبعض ظهيرا ما أنزلنا عليك القرآن لتشقى إلا تذكرة لمن يخشى تنزيلا ممن خلق الأرض والسماوات العلى تبارك الذي نزل الفرقان على عبده ليكون للعالمين نذيرا وإنه لتنزيل رب العالمين نزل به الروح الأمين على قلبك لتكون من المنذرين بلسان عربي مبين وإنه لفي زبر الأولين أولم يكن لهم آية أن يعلمه علماء بني إسرائيل وما تنزلت به الشياطين وما ينبغي لهم وما يستطيعون بل هو آيات بينات في صدور الذين أوتوا العلم إن هو إلا ذكر وقرآن مبين لينذر من كان حيا ويحق القول على الكافرين كتاب أنزلناه إليك مبارك ليدبروا آياته وليتذكر أولو الألباب قل هو نبأ عظيم الله نزل أحسن الحديث كتابا متشابها مثانية تقشعر منه جلود الذين يخشون ربهم ثم تلين جلودهم وقلوبهم إلى ذكر الله ذلك هدى الله يهدي به من يشاء إن الذين كفروا بالذكر لما جاءهم وإنه لكتاب عزيز لا يأتيه الباطل من بين يديه ولا من خلفه تنزيل من حكيم حميد وكذلك أوحينا إليك روحا من أمرنا ما كنت تدري ما الكتاب ولا الإيمان ولكن جعلناه نورا نهدي به من نشاء من عبادنا وإنه في أم الكتاب لدينا لعلي حكيم هذا بصائر للناس للناس وهدى ورحمة لقوم يوقنون والقرآن المجيد فلا أقسم بمواقع النجوم وإنه لقسم لو تعلمون عظيم إنه لقرآن كريم في كتاب مكنون لا يمسه إلا المطهرون تنزيل من رب العالمين لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن على جبل لرأيته خاشعا متصدعا من خشية الله وتلك الأمثال نضربها للناس لعلهم يتفكرون وقال تعالى عن الجن إنا سمعنا قرآنا عجبا يهدي إلى الرشد وقال تعالى بل هو قرآن مجيد في لوح محفوظ. So we'll go through the translations of those ayat now, inshallah. The month of Ramadan, in which was revealed the Quran, a guidance for mankind and clear proofs for the guidance and the criterion between right and wrong. Al-Baqarah 185. This is what we recite to you, O Muhammad, of the verses and the wise reminder, i.e. the Quran. Ali Imran 58. O mankind, verily there has come to you a convincing proof, Prophet Muhammad, from your Lord, and we sent down to you a manifest light, this Quran. Al-Nisa 174. O people of the scripture, Jews and Christians, now has come to you our messenger Muhammad, explaining to you much of that which you used to hide from the scripture and passing over, i.e. leaving out without explaining much. Indeed, there has come to you from Allah a light Prophet Muhammad and a plain book, this Quran, wherewith Allah guides all those who seek his good pleasure to ways of peace, and he brings them out of darkness by his will unto light and guides them to a straight way, i.e. Islamic monotheism upon Tawheed. Al-Ma'idah, verse 15-16. And this Qur'an is not such as could ever be produced by other than Allah, but it is a confirmation of the revelation which was before it, i.e. the Torah and the Injil, etc., and a full explanation of the book, i.e. laws and orders, etc., decreed for mankind, wherein there is no doubt from the Lord of all that exists. Yunus 37. O mankind, there has come to you good advice from your Lord, i.e. the Qur'an, ordering all that is good and forbidding all that is evil, and healing for that disease of ignorance, doubt, hypocrisy, differences, etc., in your breasts or chests, a guidance and a mercy explaining lawful and unlawful things, etc., for the believers. Yunus 57. Alif Lam Ra. This is a book, the verses whereof are perfected in every sphere of knowledge, etc., and then explained in detail from Allah, who is all-wise and well acquainted with all things. Hud, verse 1. Verily, it is we who have sent down the dhikr, the Quran, and surely we will guard it from corruption and preserve it. Al-Hijr 9. And indeed, we have bestowed upon you seven of Al-Mathani, the seven repeatedly recited verses, i.e. Surat Al-Fatiha and the Grand Quran. Look not with your eyes ambitiously at what we have bestowed on certain classes of them, the disbelievers. Nor grieve over them and lower your wings for the believers. Be courteous to the fellow believers. Al-Hijr 87-88. And we have sent down to you the book, the Quran, as an exposition of everything, a guide, a guidance, a mercy, and glad tidings for those who have submitted themselves to Allah as Muslims. Al-Nahl 89. Verily, this Quran guides to that which is most just and right and gives glad tidings to the believers in the oneness of Allah and His Messenger, Muhammad, etc., who work deeds of righteousness, that they shall have a great reward, paradise. And that those who believe not in the hereafter, who don't believe in the hereafter, i.e. they disbelieve, that they will be recompensed for what they did in this world, good or bad, etc. For them, we have prepared a painful torment, hell. Al-Isra 9-10. And we send down from the Quran that which is a healing and a mercy to those who believe in Islamic monotheism and act on it, and it increases the zalimun, polytheists and wrongdoers, nothing but loss. Al-Isra 82. And indeed, we have fully explained to mankind in this Quran every kind of similitude, but most of mankind refuse the truth and accept nothing but disbelief. Al-Isra 89. We have not sent down the Quran unto you, O Muhammad, to cause you distress, but only as a reminder to those who fear Allah, a revelation from Him, Allah, who has created the earth and high and the heavens. Surah Taha, verse 2-4. Blessed be he who sent down the criterion of right and wrong, i.e. this Quran, to his slave Muhammad, that he may be a warner to the alameen, mankind and jinns. Al-Furqan, verse 1. And truly, this, the Quran, is a revelation from the Lord of all that exists, which the trustworthy Ruh Jibrail Gabriel has brought down upon your heart, O Muhammad, that you may be one of the warners in the plain Arabic language. And verily, the Quran, its revelation to Prophet Muhammad, is announced in the scriptures, i.e. the Torah and the Injil, the Gospel of the former people, the people of the book. Is it not a sign to them that the learned scholars like Abdullah bin Salam, who embraced Islam, of the children of Israel, knew it as true? Ash-Shu'ara, verse 192-197. And it is not the devils who have brought it, this Quran, down, neither would it suit them, nor can they produce it. Ash-Shu'ara, verse 210-211. Nay, it is a collection of clear signs in the hearts of those who are given knowledge, and none but the wrongdoers deny our signs. Al-Ankabut, 49. And we have not taught him, Muhammad, poetry, nor is it suitable for him. This is only a reminder and a plain Quran, that he or it, Muhammad, or the Quran may give warning to him who is living a healthy-minded believer, and that word charge may be justified against the disbelievers, dead as they reject the warnings. Yasin 69-70. This is a book, the Quran, which we have sent down to you, full of blessings, that they may ponder over its verses, and that men of understanding may remember. Surah Sa'd 29. Allah has sent down the best statement, a book, this Quran, its parts resembling each other in goodness and truth, oft repeated. The skins of those who fear their Lord shiver from it when they recite it or hear it. Then their skin and their heart soften to the remembrance of Allah. That is the guidance of Allah. He guides therewith whom He pleases, and whomever Allah sends astray, for him there is no guide. Az-Zumar 23. Verily, those who disbelieved in the reminder, i.e. the Quran, when it came to them, shall receive the punishment. And verily, it is an honorable, respected book, because it is Allah's speech, and He has protected it from corruption, etc. Falsehood cannot come to it from before it or behind it. It is sent down by the All-Wise, worthy of all praise. Surah Fussilat 41-42. And thus we have sent you a ruh of our command. You knew not what is the book, nor what is faith, but we have made it, this Quran, a light wherewith we guide whosoever our slaves we will. Ash-Shura, verse 52. And verily, it is this Quran is in the mother of the book, i.e. the preserved tablet, before it was indeed exalted, full of wisdom. Az-Zukhruf, verse 4. This Quran is a clear insight and evidence for mankind, and a guidance and a mercy for people who have faith with certainty. Al-Jathiyah, verse 20. So I swear by the setting of the stars, and verily that is indeed a great oath, if you but know that this indeed is an honorable recital in a book well guarded with Allah in the heaven, i.e. the preserved tablet, which none can touch but the purified, a revelation from the Lord of all that exists. Al-Waqi'ah 75-80. Had we sent down this Quran on a mountain, you would surely have seen it humbling itself and rending asunder by the fear of Allah. Such are the parables which we put forward to mankind, that they may reflect. Al-Hashr, verse 21. Now this ayah was revealed specifically to the jinns as well, in particular to the jinns. Say, O Muhammad, it has been revealed to me that a group of jinns listened to this Quran. They said, verily, we have heard a wonderful recital. It guides to the right path. So we believed in it, and we will not associate partners with our Lord in worship. Al-Jinn, Surah Al-Jinn, verse 1-2. Nay, this is a glorious Quran inscribed in the preserved tablet. Al-Buruj, 21-22. So that concludes the translations of the ayahs that we read. So we'll continue with what the Shaykh was saying here. So he begins again, and he says, فَهَذِهِ الْأَوْصَافُ الْعَذِيمَةُ الْكَثِيرَةُ الَّتِي نقلناها وغيرها مما لم ننقله تدل كلها على عظمة هذا القرآن ووجوب تعظيمه وتعدب عند تلاوته والبؤذ حال قراءته عن هزع واللعب. So then the Sheikh says, these great attributes of the Quran, which we have mentioned to you, along with others that we haven't mentioned, but in particular to what we mentioned, all of them indicate the greatness of this Quran and the obligation of honoring the Quran and the proper behavior one must have and etiquettes while reciting it, including staying away from jest and play. So then the Shaykh continues and he says, فمن آداب تلاوة إخلاص النية لله تعالى فيها، لأن تلاوة القرآن من العبادات الجليلة كما سبق بيان فضلها. وقد قال الله تعالى: فادعوا الله مخلصين له الدين، فاعبد الله مخلصا له الدين. وقال تعالى: وما أمروا إلا ليعبدوا الله مخلصين له الدين حنفاء. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: اقرأوا القرآن وابتغوا به وجه الله عز وجل من قبل أن يأتي قوم يقيمونه إقامة القدح يتعجلونه ولا يتأجلونه. رواه أحمد. ومعنى يتعجلونه يطلبون به أجر الدنيا. So then the Sheikh says, he says, and from among the etiquettes of reciting the Quran is making the intention to recite sincerely for Allah, for indeed recitation is from the great acts of worship, as we have previously mentioned when talking about its virtues. Allah states in his book, invoke Allah, making religion pure and sincerely for him. Surah Al-Ghafir, verse 14. And a similar command is directed to the Prophet in the chapter entitled Az-Zumar, verse 2, in his statement, the Most High, where he said, worship Allah, making religion pure for him alone. Likewise, Allah the Most High said, they are not commanded with anything but to worship Allah alone, making religion purely and sincerely for him, and being upright and firm upon worshiping Allah alone. Surah Al-Bayyinah, verse 5. The Prophet ﷺ said, read the Quran, seeking with it the face of Allah before there come a folk who will establish it like the establishment of an arrow. They hasten its reward in this world and not the hereafter. Collected by Ahmad, and Al-Albani graded it to be sound. So then the Shaykh continues and he says, وَمِنْ أَدَابِهَا أَنْ يَقْرَأَ بِقَلْبٍ حَاضِرٍ يَتَدَبَّرُ مَا يَقْرَأُ وَيَتَفَهَمُ مَعَانِيَهُ وَيَخْشَعُ عِنْدَ ذَلِكَ قَلْبُهُ وَيَسْتَحْضِرَ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ يُخَاطِبُهُ فِيهِ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ لِأَنَّ الْقُرْآنَ كَلَامُ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلْ. So then the Shaykh says, from among the etiquettes of reciting the Quran is to recite it with a conscious heart, contemplating its meaning, seeking to comprehend them. Likewise, and then he also says, likewise from the etiquettes of the Quran is having tranquility in the heart and bearing in mind that Allah, the Most High, is addressing the reader, for indeed the Quran is a speech of Allah. So then the Shaykh continues and he says, وَمِنْ أَدَابِهَا أن يقرأ على طهارة، لأن هذا من تعظيم كلام الله عز وجل، ولا يقرأ القرآن وهو جنب حتى يغتسل إن قدر على الماء أو يتيمم إن كان عاجزا عن استعمال الماء لمرض أو عدم، وللجنب أن يذكر الله ويدعوه بما يوافق القرآن إذا لم يقصد القرآن، مثل أن يقول لا إله إلا أنت سبحانك إني كنت من الظالمين، أو يقول ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. So then the Shaykh says, from the etiquette of reciting the Quran is that you should recite it while in a state of ritual purity. By doing this, you are honoring Allah's speech as subhanahu wa ta'ala. Likewise, one should not recite the Quran while in a state of major ritual impurity until after performing the full body wash if water is available. Otherwise, perform tayammum with clean dirt or dust if you are unable to use water due to sickness or due to it not being available to you. However, even in a state of major ritual impurity, one may glorify Allah and invoke him with the invocations mentioned in the Quran, as long as one's intentions are not to actually recite the Quran. An example of this is when one says, none has a right to be worshipped but you alone, verily I am among those who wrong themselves. And also another example, O our Lord, do not cause our hearts to divert from the straight path after you have guided us, and give us mercy from you, verily you are the giver of mercy. Yeah? Surat Ali Imran. So let's continue from where the Shaykh left off here. So then the Shaykh says, وَمِنْ آدَابِهَا أَنْ لَا يَقْرَأَ الْقُرْآنَ فِي الْأَمَاكِنِ الْمُسْتَقْذَرَةِ أَوْ فِي مَجْمَعٍ لَا يُنْسَتُ فِيهِ لِقِرَاءَتِهِ لِأَنَّ قِرَاءَتَهُ فِي مِثْلِ ذَلِكَ إِهَانَةٌ لَهُ ولا يجوز أن يقرأ القرآن في بيت الخلاء ونحوه مما أعد للتبول أو التغوط لأنه لا يليق بالقرآن القرين. Also from the etiquettes of reciting the Quran is that one should not recite the Quran in filthy areas or in a sitting where the people will not keep quiet and listen to the recitation. By reciting the Quran in such a gathering, you are humiliating the Book of Allah. Likewise, one should not recite the Quran in places such as bathrooms or places that are made for the sole purpose of defecation and urination. This is not befitting for the glorious Quran. So then the Shaykh continues and he says, وَمِنْ آدَابِهَا أَنْ يَسْتَعِيذَ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ إِنْدَ إِرَادَةِ الْقِرَاءَةِ لِقَوْلِهِ تَعَالَى فَإِذَا قَرَأْتَ الْقُرْآنَ فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ وَلَئِنَّ يَصُدَّهُ الشَّيْطَانُ عَنِ الْقِرَاءَةِ أَوْ كَمَالِهَا وَأَمَّا الْبَسْمَلَةُ فَإِنْ كَانَ ابْتِدَاءُ قِرَاءَتِهِ مِنْ أَثْنَاءِ السُّورَةِ فَلَا يُبَسْمِلْ وَإِنْ كَانَ مِنْ أَوَّلِ السُّورَةِ فَلْيُبَسْمِلْ إِلَّا فِي سُورَةِ التَّوْبَةِ فَإِنَّهُ لَيْسَ فِي أَوَّلِهَا بَسْمَلَةٌ لِأَنَّ الصَّحَابَةَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ أَشْكَلَ عَلَيْهِمْ حِينَ كتابة المصحف هل هي سورة مستقلة أو بقية الأنفال ففصلوا بينهما بدون بسملة وهذا الاجتهاد هو المطابق للواقع بلا ريب إذ لو كانت البسملة قد نزلت في أولها لبقيت محفوظة بحفظ الله عز وجل لقوله تعالى إنا نحن نزلنا الذكرى وإنا له لحافظون. So then the Shaykh says, and from the among the etiquettes of reciting the Quran or the Book of Allah is that one must seek refuge with Allah from the devil when intending to recite. This is based on Allah's statement: when you recite the Quran, seek refuge with Allah from the Satan, the outcast. Surah Nahl, verse 98. So you say, "A'udhu billahi min shaitan rajim, Bismillahi r-Rahmani r-Rahim." And by doing this, the reciter will be safe from the devil's plot, which turns him away from reciting the book of his Lord or from completing it. But as for the basmala, and that is saying Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, if he starts his recitation from other than the beginning of the chapter, then he should not say the basmala. But if he starts his recitation in the beginning of the chapter, then he should begin it with the basmala, except when reciting the beginning of Surah At-Tawbah, because it does not have a basmala in its beginning. This is because it was difficult upon the companions to determine whether it is a chapter by itself or whether it was a continuation of Surah Al-Anfal, the Surah before it. So they have separated between them without the Basmala. And what they have agreed upon is a right decision without any doubt. Because if there was a Basmala in its beginning, it will have been preserved because Allah Jalla Wa'ala has guaranteed to preserve His book, as He, the Most High, said, Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidun. Verily, it is we who reveal this book and send down this book, and it is we who will preserve it. Surah Al-Hijr, verse 9. So then the Shaykh continues and he says, وَمِنْ أَدَابِهَا أَنْ يُحَسَّنَ صَوْتَهُ بِالْقُرْآنِ وَيَتَرَنَّمُ بِهِ لما في الصحيحين من حديث أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال ما أذن الله لشيء أي ما استمع لشيء كما أذن لنبي حسن الصوت يتغنى بالقرآن يجهر به وفيهما عن جبير بن المطعم رضي الله عنه قال سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقرأ في المغرب بالتور فما سمعت أحدا أحسن صوتا أو قراءة منه صلى الله عليه وسلم لكن إن كان حول القارئ أحد يتأذى بجهره في قراءته كالنائم والمصلي ونحوهما فإنه لا يجهر جهرا يشوش عليه أو يؤذيه لأن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خرج على الناس وهم يصلون ويجهرون بالقراءة فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إن المصلي يناجي ربه فلينظر بما يناجيه به ولا يجهر بعضكم على بعض في القرآن رواه مالك في الموطأ وقال ابن عبد البر وَهُوَ حَدِيثٌ صَحِيحٌ. So then the Shaykh says, and also from the etiquettes of reciting the Quran is to beautify one's voice, reciting it in a beautiful melody, in a melodious way. This is based on what is mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim from the hadith of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, who said that the Prophet ﷺ said, Allah did not listen to anything more than his listening to the Prophet, who has a beautiful voice reciting the Book of Allah in a beautiful melody and proclaiming it, collected by Al-Bukhari and Muslim. It is also narrated in Sahih al-Bukhari and Sahih Muslim from the narration of Jubair ibn Mut'im radiallahu anhu, who said, I heard the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam reciting Surah At-Tur during the Maghrib prayer. I have never heard anyone who has better recitation than him sallallahu alayhi wasallam, collected by Al-Bukhari and Muslim. Then the Shaykh says, however, if there are people around him who may be disturbed with his loud voice, such as the one who is praying, for example, or the one who is sleeping, and those similar to those examples, in this case, he should not raise his voice in a manner that disturbs or harms them. This is because the Prophet ﷺ once came out to the people and found them praying, raising their voices while reciting. So the Prophet ﷺ said, the one who prays is holding a conversation with his Lord. Therefore, let him see what does he converse his Lord, and let not some of you raise their voices over the other when reciting the Quran. Narrated by Imam Malik in Al-Muwatta, and Ibn Abdul Barr said it is authentic. So then the Shaykh continues, and he says, وَمِنْ أَدَابِهَا أَنْ يُرَتِّلِ الْقُرْآنَ تَرْتِيلًا لِقَوْلِهِ تَعَالَى وَرَتِّلِ الْقُرْآنَ تَرْتِيلًا فَيَقْرَعُهُ بِتَمَهُّلٍ بِدُونِ سُرْعَةٍ لِأَنَّ ذَلِكَ أَعْوَنُ عَلَى تَدَبُّرِ مَعَانِيهِ وَتَقْوِيمِ حُرُوفِهِ وَأَلْفَاظِهِ. وَفِي صَحِيحِ الْبُخَارِي عَنْ أَنَسِ بْنُ مَالِكٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ أَنَّهُ سُئِلَ عَنْ قِرَاءَةِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَقَالَ كَانَتْ مَدًّا ثُمَّ قَرَأَ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ يَمُدُّ بسم الله ويمد الرحمن ويمد الرحيم. وسئلت أم سلمة رضي الله عنها عن قراءة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقالت كان يقطع قراءته آية آية, أي بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين. رواه أحمد وأبو داود والترمذي وقال ابن مسعود رضي الله عنه لا تنثروه نثر الرمل ولا تهذوه هذ الشعر كفوا عند عجائبه وحركوا به القلوب ولا يكن هم أحدكم آخر سورة ولا بأس بالسرعة التي ليس فيها إخلال باللفظ بإسقاط بعض الحروف أو إدغام ما لا يصح إدغامه فإن كان فيها إخلال باللفظ فهي حرام لأنها تغيير للقرآن. So then the Shaykh says, so from the etiquettes of reciting the Book of Allah is to recite it slowly in a manner that is clear and touching. This is because of Allah's statement, recite the Quran aloud in a slow, pleasant tone and style. Surah Al-Muzammil, verse 4. This is because by reciting it in that manner, it will help you to ponder and contemplate on its meanings and give its letters and words their rights of articulation, i.e. tajweed. It is mentioned in Sahih al-Bukhari from the narration of Anas ibn Malik, radiallahu anhu, when he was asked about the recitation of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he replied, he used to recite deliberately, and then he recited Surah Al-Fatiha to demonstrate to the people how the Prophet ﷺ used to recite, narrated by Ahmad Abu Dawud and At-Tirmidhi. Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu said, do not spread it like the spreading of the dust, and do not recite it very fast like the way they say a poem. Stand by its wonders and shake hearts with it. Let not your concerns be based on completing the entire Quran. So then the Shaykh says, there is nothing wrong with reciting it fast as long as it does not affect the wording or lead to dropping out some of the letters or merging together letters that are not supposed to be merged together. If it leads to violation of its wording, then it is impermissible because this changes the meaning of the Quran or what you're reciting from the Quran. So then the Sheikh continues and he says, وَمِنْ آدَابِهَا أَنْ يَسْجُدَ إِذَا مَرَّ بِآيَةِ السَّجْدَةٍ وَهُوَ عَلَى وُضُوءٍ فِي أَيِّ وَقْتٍ كَانَ مِنْ لَيْلٍ أَوْ نَهَارٍ فَيُكَبِّرُ لِلسُّجُودِ وَيَقُولُ سُبْحَانَ رَبِّيَ الْعَلَى ويدعو ثم يرفع من السجود بدون تكبير ولا سلام لأنه لم يرد عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إلا أن يكون السجود في أثناء الصلاة فإنه يكبر إذا سجد وإذا قام بحديث أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أنه كان يكبر في الصلاة كلما خفض ورفع ويحدث أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يفعل ذلك رواه مسلم وعن ابن مسعود رضي الله عنه قال رأيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يكبر في كل رفع وخفض وقيام وقعود رواه أحمد والنسائي.